Take a look.
Perhaps it's a witch.
Of course not. Witches have brooms.
It's that Poppins woman, Mary Poppins.
Oh, of course. Mary Poppins.
Mary Poppins. Is that your name?
That's her name. And here's the behind-the-scenes story of the making of Walt Disney's supercalifragilisticexpialidocious masterpiece.
Mary Poppins, practically perfect in every way.
Mary Poppins, which was filmed on this soundstage, was the studio's triumph of special effects, animation, and live action. It also won 5 Oscars, more than any single Disney film had before or since. But those of us who worked on the film, and all of us who've come to love it, know it was the story beneath the special effects that turned the movie into an enduring classic.
In a way, Mary Poppins is the culmination of Walt's career, in that it draws on everything he'd learned how to do, blending animation and live action, integrating songs with story, and of course, not the least, his great eye for talent. Because after all, he's the one who brought Julie Andrews to Hollywood for the first time to make this film.
What many people don't realize is that Walt Disney's interest in Mary Poppins dated back to 1939. Mary Poppins had been published in 1934 and was wildly popular in England. Walt's brother Roy Disney began negotiations with the author, P.L. Travers, in 1944, while Travers was living in New York to escape the Nazi bombings of London. Many years went by, but the tenacious Mrs. Travers finally released the film rights to the equally determined Mr. Disney in 1961.
Mary Poppins is a live musical fantasy. The whole story is carried out by live actors, and it's a... Of course, we have a lot of tricks of the trade here that we incorporated into Mary Poppins.
Instead of giving the book to a screenwriter or animation director, Walt first called upon songwriters to look at Mary Poppins.
Our songwriters, Dick and Bob Sherman.
The Sherman brothers had started working for Walt doing incidental songs, but when he came to them and proposed Mary Poppins, this was on a, again, on a different plateau. He knew it, and he made them know it too. He got them involved in helping to build the story. The songs came out of the story, and the story led to the songs. It was a perfect integration of music and storytelling.
One day, Walt handed us a book, and it was Mary Poppins. And he said, read it and tell me what you fellas think about it. And
we circled 6 chapters.
An amazing thing happened.
Walt opened his copy of the book, and he had circled the same 6 chapters.
What a feeling.
The Sherman brothers set to work with story man Don DeGrady, who developed their story ideas through drawings.
Don DeGrady came in one day with a sketch of a little chimney sweep carrying his brooms and whistling. And I said, this is a song.
Chim chimini, chim chimini, chim chim cheree. When you're with a sweep, you're in glad company.
Nowhere is there a more happier crew than them what sings chim chim cheree, chim cheroo.
Casting the pivotal role of the Magic Nanny, a bright young musical star caught Walt's eye.
It's Julie Andrews, incomparable Broadway star of My Fair Lady and Camelot.
How did you pick Julie for the part?
Well, I went to New York and I caught the performance of Camelot. Of course, I'd heard her records and things, but it was Camelot that I saw her in. And then I went backstage and I tried to talk her into the thing, and I tried to convince her I was capable of making a picture with live actors as well as cartoons. I didn't know what she thought of me and everything. I think I put on quite an act there that night, didn't I?
Impressed, Walt.
For a spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down.
When you see Julie Andrews and Mary Poppins, she's so perfect. She's so wonderful. You wonder how anybody could have turned her down for anything. And yet, the great irony was that was the same year that My Fair Lady came to the screen, and that was the role that she had made her own on Broadway. But Jack Warner of Warner Brothers passed her by for the movie. He didn't think that she was movie material.
In a casting choice that many critics thought odd, Walt chose All-American Dick Van Dyke as Mary Poppins' Cockney companion, Bert.
Well, it's my third motion picture, but the best one I've ever been in, the best one I ever will be in if I live to be 150 years old.
Oh, it's a jolly holiday with Mary. Mary makes your odds so light.
You haven't changed a bit, have you?
Dick Van Dyke was known by then as the star of his weekly TV comedy series, and he was wonderful in it. But he'd already been on Broadway as a musical comedy star in Bye Bye Birdie. And Mary Poppins let him show all his talents. A natural dancer, a wonderful singer, a man of just tremendous charm and presence.